I'm Will.
And I'm Elizabeth.
And we're the Gillians.
This is Kingdom News Now.
And it's time to testify.
No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, than here in your love. There's no place I would rather be. No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be than here in your love, than here in your love.
Hello, friends. I'm Jack Dilday of Kingdom News Now, and I want to take just a couple moments to share something with you that's very dear to my heart tonight, and that is Midnight Cry Intercession. Back when Lisa and I were pastoring locally here in Poplar Bluff, we began Midnight Cry once a month on Friday nights. We would gather together to pray for the needs of others and intercede for those that was in need of anything from the Lord. And we would pray from 8 o'clock till midnight once a month on Friday night. And we would gather prayer requests from anywhere around the area, anywhere around the country, actually anywhere in the world that we knew people that needed prayer for any specific needs. And we would pray for those during those 4 hours from 8 till midnight once a month on Friday night. But when we transitioned from pastoring locally here in Poplar Bluff to the program here at Kingdom News Now, we set up our Facebook page called Midnight Cry, and we began to take prayer requests through that avenue. And so I want to talk to you for just a few moments tonight, really what Midnight Cry is and how important it is. I not only believe just to us, but I believe it's important for you and to God as well. So, you know, intercessory prayer is a type of prayer that you put yourself in between the enemy and someone else who has a need. You know, you begin to intercede for them. Jesus was the great intercessor. He put himself between death and us. So when we begin to intercede for someone, what we are doing in essence is putting ourselves in between that person and the enemy, which puts us closer to the enemy than what they are. And we stand in between them and the enemy, and we pray and we intercede. You know, we're not required to do what Jesus did. We're not required to give our life such as he gave for you and I. But we are required to do something. And let's pray one for another. God does use those who will place themselves between the enemy and someone else. He calls people to do that. And not only does he call people to do that, I know our first thought is, well, you know, I'm not called to be an intercessor. Well, I beg to differ with you, because I believe, number one, James chapter 5, I believe it's verse 8, James chapter 5, verse 16 says, pray ye one for another that you may be healed. So you are called to pray for others. You are called to intercede for others. If you are born again, child of God, if you know Jesus Christ is your Savior and you claim to be on your way to heaven, you are called to pray one for another. You are called to intercede. You are an intercessor. You know, we're to intercede not only for one another, but we're to intercede for our nation. No other day in history does our nation need any more prayer than what it does today. This nation's in a mess. This nation is divided right down the middle. And the answer is not going to be found in who's in the White House. The answer is going to be found in God's house. The answer is going to be found with God's children. The answer is going to be found on our knees, praying and seeking and interceding for our nation. That's where the answer is going to come from. That's the only thing that's going to turn this nation around and turn it back to God. And we are called to do that. You know, I mentioned James chapter 5, verse 16 says, pray ye one for another that you may be healed. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8 teaches us that what we make happen for one, God will make happen for us. When we begin to pray and intercede for someone, God will lay it on someone else's heart to pray and intercede for us. That's just the way he works. I don't know how it happens. He just does that. Pray ye one for another that you may be healed. I'm called and anointed to pray for you so I can get what I need. You are called and anointed to pray for someone else so you can get what you need. We need to take the focus off of ourselves and place it on someone else. That's what intercession is when we begin to pray for someone else besides ourselves. And you are called to be an intercessor. And I want to invite you to take just a moment to go to our Midnight Cry Facebook page, and the address is on the screen, facebook.com/midnightcry, the number one, like the page, and post your most urgent need on that page. And know that people from around the world is praying for you. And not only are they praying for you, but you have an obligation and responsibility to be praying for them as well. Scroll through the page, find the prayer request that's on there, and begin to pray for those needs that's on there. I know God will bless you for it. I know it's not only close to my heart, I believe it's close to God's heart. You are called to be an intercessor. You are anointed to pray for people. You're anointed to pray one for another, and God will see to it that your needs are met. Amen. Thank you. Welcome to Kingdom News Now. I'm Jack Dilday right here in the studios here in Poplar Bluff, Missouri. We're so glad that you joined us tonight for another program. We are excited about what God is doing throughout this region, Southeast Missouri and around. And so we're just looking forward to what God has even during this next 60 minutes on this program, because we've got some great things to share with you of what's taking place throughout our region in this area. We've got a couple special guests with us tonight. And even while I introduce them, I want you to go to your phone and get online. We're live on Facebook tonight as well. You can go to the phone, call your friends and family and your pastors. We want to target some pastors tonight. We want to talk to some pastors in this area tonight. So be sure and call your pastor and tell them. Join us on Kingdom News Now tonight. We've got a special program lined up for them. We've got in the studio with us tonight Pastor Greg Gilberto, again, 2 weeks in a row.
Oh my.
From North Point Nazarene Church. Amen. Pastor Greg is with us, and we're glad to have you back with us tonight.
Thanks, Jack. Always a pleasure to be here. To meet this guy, Ed Shirrell, what a great new friend we've Amen. Made. And you're going to hear some great things from this man with a vision. But I'm just filler. You're going to run the show, and we'll just use this thing. But you need to hear from this man's heart.
Amen.
Because it's amazing. Sabbath Rest Retreat Center.
Yes,
amen. Is what we're going to talk about today, and Brother Ed, it's honestly the first time I met you, I liked you, and the more I know you, I love you. You're one of us.
Hey,
it's pretty awesome. But tell us a little bit. What in the world? What even made you think about this retreat? How did this even come about?
Well, kind of quickly, just background. I wasn't raised in church. You guys may have been. I was not. Got saved at 21 after Vietnam. On a college campus at SEMO, and a biker led me to the Lord. And met my wife there, and we actually lived here in Poplar Bluff 40 years ago. She's a special ed teacher, and she calls me special ed once in a while. I don't know if you have not really. I have a great marriage, great wife. Anyway.
Met Karen today. She's a sweet lady.
We lived here in Poplar Bluff for a couple of years, and was actually a deacon in a church here, and worked with the Gideons and Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship, mm-hmm. and felt called to ministry, moved to Texas back in 1977, and returned to Missouri in 1979, started pastoring a little church called Burney, Missouri, a little town, and was there for 3.5 years, and later moved to House Springs. It's about 15 miles east of Six Flags. And after 36 years of ministry, I've been pregnant for the last 10 years almost with this vision of providing a place for pastors and their wives to experience a sabbatical. And when I speak to pastors, most of them have never taken a sabbatical. They know what it means. They understand the theology of it, but when it comes to the practicality, very few have. You may be aware of this. Pastors are, according to George Barna and H.B. London, 1,500 pastors a month leave the ministry in the United States.
Every month.
Every month. That's 18,000 a year. Wow. Last year, about 3,500 churches closed their doors. And having experienced burnout myself, I just have this burden, a passion to help pastors. So we transitioned from ministry in House Springs a couple of years ago and started this ministry. And we're basically our point or our tag is to provide a place for pastors and their spouses to experience a sabbatical, to rest, to refocus and be renewed to accomplish their God-given purpose. And a lot of pastors are burning out.
That's a great mission.
That's what we're doing. So we live about an hour north of you and out in the middle of nowhere. And you guys came today, and
beautiful.
It was a miracle that you made it, but I did meet you at the highway.
That's right.
And so,
The sun kind of gave us a little direction, and there you were.
Hey, you know.
It was a beautiful thing.
It wasn't at the end of the rainbow, but.
No, it's close.
It is a beautiful, beautiful place and beautiful area through there. I want to go back just a second. You was in ministry 36 years.
Yes, sir.
You pastored.
Pastored 36
years. For 36
years.
That's a long time.
That's a long time. And 32 of those years.
Was that the same church in House Springs?
Was at the same church in House Springs.
See, most people, Ed, if you don't mind me saying, most people say, well, I'm done now.
Yeah.
It's time to relax. Not you. Your retirement years are now.
Refired
or refocused. So that in itself is a miracle, isn't it?
Yes, it is. But it's exciting. As we talked before the show about God prepares you for where you're at today.
Yes, he does.
And he prepares you where you're at for where you're going. So we're going, we're excited. My wife, we're not young. I'm 66. I won't tell you how old my wife is because my life could depend on it.
That'd be really dangerous.
But just to befriend pastors. Many pastors are lonely. They're tired of working with troubled people, conflict in their church. Maybe it's a board member, an elder. They become weary.
Well, now, you know, a pastor, all he has to do is prepare 3 messages a week and preach.
I've heard that.
And drink coffee.
Yeah, he goes, you know, plays golf.
And donuts.
You know?
Well,
one stat? I think you told me the stat at our men's prayer when we met the other day. Was that 10%, less than 10% of, tell me if I'm right here, less than 10% of pastors that are pastoring currently will not retire as pastors.
That's correct.
So is that stat right?
That's correct. And also the first, a pastor that starts in ministry 10 years later, 60% of them will be out of ministry in 10 years.
See, wow. I've been a minister for 30 years, and Jack is saying, you know, we've made it, I guess. I don't even know what that means, but we've had our share.
Yeah.
There's a couple times I probably could have gone to a retreat center if you had one, but now we have one. And it is beautiful.
Absolutely.
And tell us about how's the building. I mean, we were there, but let the people know about what your vision is and what you, because I just think it's awesome.
Well, we want to provide a place. Having burnout several times in ministry years ago, I used to go to a park one day a week, and I'd take an ice bucket with me in the summer and a blanket, and I'd take a nap, and I'd read, and I'd study. And we had pagers back then, and my secretary would not page me unless it was a true emergency or my wife. And I tried to spend that time resting with God. The word, three words. One is Sabbath, which means rest. It means cease from working. For a pastor, it's hard to turn off ministry because you love people. Somebody always has a need, and if they don't, their second cousin does. We know how that works. And so there's always a need there. And I would go and spend the day and come back somewhat refreshed. Later, I graduated about every 2 months. I would go to a motel and spend 2 days and one night. That became too expensive. Plus, you've got rooms around you, noise. And so about 10 years ago, 11 now, I started building this house at the farm near Zalma, Missouri. It's west of Arab. And I would leave House Springs, and my mind would be kind of hurting, and my back was fine. But after working a couple of days, leave one morning at 4 o'clock, work all day, rest, work the next day, and get back at midnight the following night. When I went back, my head was fine, but my back hurt. And my point was, that wasn't a true sabbatical, but I was disengaged from ministry. So one word, Sabbath, is rest. A second word is, somebody would say, Pastor, you just need to take a vacation. Vacations are not about rest.
Right.
You come home to rest.
Yeah.
The third word, though, is retreat, and it's where pastors, why we call this a retreat center. It's a time to reflect. If you don't take time to reflect and hear from God, in ministry, you will wander in the wilderness. You'll do the same thing year in and year out. And during that times of reflection, it's you get a fresh word from God, a fresh anointing. You hear from God. And again, our three taglines are rest, refocus, and be renewed. Mm-hmm. A pastor who's renewed is healthy. He will produce health in that church, all things being equal, because the Holy Spirit's going to help him.
Amen.
Holy Spirit's going to help you whether you're happy or sad.
Sure.
but he works through health. And if you're healthy, you produce health. Mm-hmm. And so my goal is to provide a place. I didn't have a place to go. I'm at a park, a county park, then I'm a motel, and I'm out in the woods. I'm in the middle of nowhere, and that's where we want to be.
You know, you're sitting listening to you talk about this. I remember when I pastored up Central Missouri, and we had a relatively, you know, probably small church compared to a lot of them. We had less than 100 people, right? Probably close to 100 people. And I remember our children at that time was all at home and young, and, you know, we had a little one running around then. And I'm talking back in the mid-90s, mid to late 90s. And our girls was teenagers and such. But in order for us to get away from the phones and everything, what we chose to do at that time, because we wasn't anywhere around what you're doing either at that
right.
time, but what we chose to do, we would we joined the what they call racquetball club down at Lake of the Ozarks, which was a getaway place. It was, you know, obviously vacation area there at the lake.
Sure.
But we would take off and go down there one evening, leave all our phones at home, and not, you know, not mess with anything. We'd take our kids and go down there for an evening, or, you know, we'd do it at least once a week. You know, how many times do we sit down at the kitchen table to eat dinner and phone ring?
Right.
Absolutely.
You know, when you're pastoring. Now, that don't happen to me so often anymore. Sometimes it does, but not as often.
Right.
You know, but when you're pastoring. And you know, they don't know that you're just now sitting down to eat necessarily, because they've got a crisis going on.
Sure.
Right. You know, and but I'm just saying, so we just chose a night of the week to do that, just to get away in what you're talking about.
You know, when we were talking today, you brought up the deal about the phones. It's a different world today.
Oh, absolutely.
Everyone's connected. I mean, I put my phone down here because I didn't want it ring while we were on in your studio. But even, Ed, you were telling us, we're going to make this like phone-free,
yes.
Wi-Fi free. I mean, it's, you're going to go up there, you're going to hear nothing but the Lord.
The voice
which
of
is
God.
Awesome.
Right.
And that in itself is just like, that's really cool. I remember one the other day, my phone, like, I think it died. It would not restart. And for about 2 hours, I was real anxious. I'm going, well, I know someone's trying to get a hold of me, you know. So I'm looking around for somewhere to call somebody. But after I got past that 2 hours, I'm going, I could like this a lot. We need to disconnect.
Absolutely.
To really
right.
reconnect. And I right. guess that's the refocus you're talking about, isn't it?
It is. And you know, you can't do it at your house.
No,
I won't say it's almost impossible to leave, and just being with, you know, if you're a deer hunter, I hunt deer. That's nice to be on a deer stand, but I'm talking about being alone with God,
yeah.
hearing God's voice, and you know, where I'm at. I've asked pastors, why don't you take a sabbatical? I've asked myself, and one is I don't have a place to go. So where I'm at, if you take a two-hour drive, a circle, you can go to Festus, Missouri, Carbondale, Illinois, Winona, and Arkansas. In that circle is 2,500 pastors. The second reason why pastors don't take a sabbatical is they don't have any money.
And cost, right.
So it's very economical. And a third reason is sometimes pastors are afraid their congregation will think they're lazy. Well, some of them do anyway. The common joke is a pastor works one day a week.
Yeah.
However, if you're serious about pleasing God instead of your congregation, you'll spend time with God, because that time will produce fruit that you could never do by yourself.
Right.
And so I share with pastors, you've got to quit trying to be a people pleaser and be a God pleaser.
Right.
And that takes
Amen.
Faith,
Amen.
As we all know, in reality.
Yeah.
And the retreat is really not, the retreat's a good thing.
Sure.
It's a good thing. And it used to, well, that's almost like a form of I think some people use the word lazy. That's okay. I have trouble being lazy. I have trouble sitting still for 10 minutes. But when I do, it's wonderful.
Right.
And God speaks. That still small voice still works.
Yes.
Sure, man?
Yes, he does.
So.
You know, I when you was talking a while ago, but just a couple minutes ago about the phone, I grinned at you and I laughed, not at what you were saying, but my phone in my shirt pocket is vibrating.
Like right now?
It was.
That's perfect.
Yeah, somebody was trying to call. And I try to get a hold of our children when we're recording and taping so they don't call.
Right.
You know?
Yeah,
but
we're connected, aren't we?
Absolutely, yeah. We're connected by that. And like, you know, like you said, like Brother Ed said, you know, at Sabbath Rest, there at the facility, there is no Wi-Fi.
Correct.
Very little, if any, phone signal.
Correct.
You found that out.
You know, you just kind of disconnect, and that's exactly what we're talking about. That's exactly what sometimes pastors need.
It's absolutely beautiful. You said it was economical, less than economical. What's it going to cost for, like, let's just say that Jackie and I want to, we're going to leave Poplar Bluff, and we just want a couple days at Sabbath Rest. How does this work? What does it cost?
It costs $25 a night for you and your wife.
Okay.
And we're providing non-perishable food. So if you crunch the numbers, you're talking $15, $20 at the most.
Oh, my, that's wonderful.
So it's economical. The pastor of the large church can normally afford a retreat, but the average pastor, 100, 200 people, they cannot. And so I call this the working pastors group, for lack of a better word.
That's awesome.
And most pastors, if you're, your congregation, if you're listening, the average pastor works 60 to 70 hours a week.
Right.
You can't turn ministry off. And I'm not apologizing or whining. I'm just stating the reality.
That's the fact.
There's a cliche that says, if you burn the candle at both ends, you can't be very bright.
Right.
Well, if you keep the spring tight all the time, it's not going to work. And the average parishioner that calls you, they don't realize everybody else is calling you. They don't mean harm. But I consider a retreat, a sabbatical, an investment. If you want to bless your family, Pastor, you need to do a retreat. If you want to bless your church, do a retreat. It's an investment.
That's good.
Now, yeah. I pay my bills to Ozark Border Electric for my electric. I never consider that an investment. It's an expense. And there's nothing wrong with that, but you need to invest in yourself and what God's called you to do and not apologize for it.
Right. And everything, we were there today, and you'll see some pictures on our Facebook and the website and everything. It's done. Everything is done so far. First class. I mean, it's absolutely beautiful.
Right.
Countertops, everything's spacious. And what you've done an excellent job. And we want to thank you in advance. I know you're going to help. The kingdom of God is going to be better because what's been birthed in you. And do you have like a target date? How long? And I know the main building's almost finished, right?
Yes.
Can we say that?
Yeah, the main building's almost finished. We should be open in early spring. It's a lodge with two apartments. I call it two cabins above. And then we want to place five other cabins around it and a pavilion. And I was sharing with you guys today with these two apartments. They're huge. They're big.
Huge.
They're spacious. It's a lodge. It's wood. But in 1 year, two apartments, we could host 104 pastors and their wives if they came and spent a week.
Amen.
So to me, this isn't about me really having a dream. This is about me following God's dream.
Right.
And how to be a blessing to the kingdom. Your program is Kingdom News Now. Right. Well, I want to be a blessing to the kingdom.
Amen. This fits perfect.
Definitely.
There's a marriage here, pretty obvious. Huh?
I've had somebody say, well, what do you get out of it, Pastor? I don't get anything. We don't receive any salaries.
Yeah.
This is not about me. It's about helping people.
Right.
And
it's a God-fused vision, and you're following through. Now, there's some needs. I know that
in just a moment, we're going to go through the needs, and there's some other things I want Brother Ed to talk about, but we need to take a break we have something coming up that I know you're going to enjoy tonight, and that is Miss Holly Garces with Kingdom Truth for Today. In fact, let me mention to you, those of you that's watching the program tonight, those of you that's watching by Facebook tonight, Miss Holly Garces is going to be in a studio with us next week when we record. So she's going to do a full program with us. She is this young lady is taking the internet by storm.
Hey Jack, can I say this about her? She is the next generation. She is the Beth Moore of the next generation.
Amen. I believe that.
She's that type of
the anointing that is on her life.
She's sweet, she's lovable, but boy, I tell you, she could really she's a teacher.
She is a teacher. She's a fireball, she's anointed to do what she is doing. And so I'm glad that she has come on board with us here at Kingdom News Now. But next week she's going to be on the program with us, so she's going to do a full program. We may just turn her loose and let her preach while she's here. So don't miss next week's program. Those of you watching my Facebook, be sure and be with us. I know she's going to want to do it live next week on Facebook. So anyway, just as an announcement to you there. But we're going to take a break. Kingdom Truth for Today is coming up. Amen. We're going to be right back here with Pastor Ed Shirrell from Sabbath Rest. Amen. So don't go nowhere. We'll be right back.
Hi guys, this is Holly truths for today. And I am so excited that you guys are joining me through Facebook Live this week. And we've had a lot of good response with that. So I'm hoping you guys enjoy the word that I have for you. You might be wondering, out of all the places I've recorded, why did I choose on the platform of Church on the Rock in this particular spot? Well, this particular spot is where my life was forever changed. So I kind of wanted to share that with you guys tonight, because we've been talking for the past few weeks about revival. And, you know, I feel like a lot of times we think revival is all these events going on or all these services, but it's really a personal encounter with Jesus. Revival is a reoccurring thing. Revival is when God's heart is so deeply touched, he can't help but to respond. So about 3 years ago, 3 to 4 years ago, on a Sunday night, I was just bound with depression and anxiety and fear and just rejection and shame. And I was in a horrible relationship, a really verbally abusive relationship. And I had a bunch of scars from church hurt and just anger. And I was a mess, to be honest with you. And that afternoon, I had came in to the praise team rehearsal, and we were practicing Break Every Chain, the song. And in that moment, I was so angry because I saw all of these other people worshiping God, and I wanted to be so free so desperately. And I remember I went into my dad's office, and I clung to the carpet, and I said, God, I know you are a chain-breaking God, but I need you to show me that tonight. So I came back out here, the service had started, and we didn't even get to the first verse of the song. And I hit the floor, and just tears streaming down my face, and I repented, I rededicated my life to God that night. And let me tell you, there's something so amazing that when you are in the presence of God and you feel literally every chain breaking off of you. I got up that night changed, forever changed. It changed everything about me. I truly felt free for the very first time. I had been a Christian my whole entire life, but the first time I actually felt like I knew who Jesus was. So I really experienced revival, and I experienced the person that set my soul on fire. And so what I kind of wanted to talk about tonight was the story of Jacob. Many of you guys, it's in Genesis. I believe it's in 32, verse 4, 34. And he talks about, you know, Jacob wrestled with God, the angel of God. And it said that Jacob told him, I'm not letting you go till you bless me. And so they were constantly wrestling all night long. And the angel of the Lord touched Jacob's hip, and it left Jacob limp. Well, I thought, you know, for a while, why out of all the things did it leave him limp? Why didn't it leave like a cool saying on his arm, or why didn't it leave him, you know, mute or whatever? Well, because Jacob walked with a limp for the rest of his life. So when you truly experience revival, you walk differently than others. You don't walk where other people walk. You might walk out of things that people walk into. You might walk into things that other people walk out of, but you walk differently than others. That's true revival. When you can come up to someone, they say, hey, something's different about you. Well, I wrestled with God one night. It's a conversation starter, to be honest with you. But that's what it is. You're different. You're marked. You are forever set apart by God. You can't go where other people go. You know, and I've had to learn that with revival. I can't go where other people go, and that's okay because I've encountered something better. Tonight in youth, I talked about the woman with the well, that when she truly met Jesus, she left her water jar at the well. Well, and I asked myself, why something so precious, she carried that water jug from her town all the way to the well, why would she just leave it there? Because she didn't need it anymore. Because she met something that satisfied all of her needs. She got a drink of the true living water. And when you truly experience God, normal church services don't satisfy you anymore. When you truly experience the living God, that bad relationship you're in that you know you shouldn't be in, it doesn't satisfy you anymore. When you truly experience God, sex doesn't matter to you anymore. When you truly experience God, money and the things of this world, they have no hold on you anymore. Most of all, when you truly experience God and he wraps his arms around you, those chains can't wrap themselves on you anymore. And that's my testimony. This is where I encountered revival. And like I said before, revival is a daily choice. It is waking up every morning and saying, though none go with me, still I'm going to follow. That is revival. Revival will cost you. It's going to cost you popularity. It's going to cost you relationships. It's going to cost you friends. It's going to cost you, you know, people talking about you. It's going to cost you. But friend, it is so worth it. When you truly get a drink of the living God, nothing else comprehends. Nothing else matters. And I want to encourage you tonight, you know, and I'd ask God, you know, out of all the things I could talk about with revival, why did you have me talk about my personal experience? But because there might be a teenage girl out there and you're in a bad relationship right now, and you've got the chain of rejection wrapped around you so tightly that you feel like you can't breathe. Well, sweetheart, I'm here to tell you that chain cannot have a hold on you when you truly meet the living God. You might be a wife tonight and you're in a horrible marriage and you're in an abusive relationship. Well, that chain of shame and not being wanted, that can't have a hold on you when you meet God, because he wants you with every part of him. The Bible says he's jealous for you. He has zeal for you. You might be tonight battling with depression or suicidal thoughts. Trust me, I've been there. Those lies that the enemy is whispering in your ears, they have no hold on you any longer when you truly experience the living God. You look at all through history and all through the Bible. When those people met God, they never went back to the same. Look at blind Bartimaeus. You don't see the Bible saying once Jesus touched him, he walked around with his eyes closed. No, he went and told the whole city that God truly changed his life. Why? Because he didn't go back to the thing God delivered him from. You never see the woman at the well going back to that well. She left her jug there. Why? Because she truly experienced something. You don't see Peter, who walked on the water with Jesus, going back to being a fisherman. Why? Because he experienced something that was better than life itself. So I want to tell you tonight, if you're feeling wrapped around with chains and wrapped around with depression and suicidal thoughts or anger or hurt, I have something for you, and that's called Jesus, and it is better. And once you truly experience him, nothing else will satisfy you. And so tonight, I truly hope and pray that this ministers to someone, because it's heavy on my heart. But revival, you might grow up like me in your church your whole life, and you've truly not even experienced revival. Revival is not someone laying hands on you and you falling out on the floor and speaking in tongues and crying. That's not revival. Revival is you getting up one day and saying, you know what, I'm not going to cuss anymore. I'm not going to sleep with my boyfriend anymore. I'm not going to drink anymore. I'm not going to do this anymore. It is truly a revolution. It turns you a totally different direction. That is what true revival is. And I keep praying, God, let us truly encounter revival. I'm done with church services. I'm done with the pastor telling me to live like this. And I leave the doors and I leave the same way I came in. I'm tired of that. I want to experience revival. So wherever you are, if you're watching on Facebook Live, or if you're watching on the program, or if you're sitting in your living room, if you're sitting at Applebee's, wherever you are, I want you to bow your head right now, and we're going to pray. And I want the same spirit that broke every chain off of me that night on a cold January night to break every chain off of you. So Father God, we come to you right now, Father, and Lord, I pray that every chain that has been wrapped around these people is broken off in Jesus' name. Every chain of religion has to be broken. Every chain of rejection has to be broken. Every chain of shamelessness has to be broken. Every chain, God, of depression and anxiety and fear and hurt has to be broken off in Jesus' name. God, open our eyes. Open the church's eyes, God, to truly experience revival like we never have before. Make us thirsty again, Father. You said those that hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. God, we're asking you tonight, Lord, to make us hungry. If we're not hungry, make us hungry. If we're not seeking after you, God, then rip everything away until we seek after you. Strip everything away, God, till all we have is you. God, we want revival. We don't want church. We don't want another sermon, but we want the true living God to just invade our lives, Father. We give you all the glory and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. I pray wherever you are right now that that touched you, and I pray that you truly experience God for yourself, because I promise you, when you taste him, you will say, I tasted and seen that the Lord is good. So thank you guys for joining this week. I hope it blessed you. And remember to go like my page. It's Passion, Presence, and Pearls. Or you can find me on Facebook at Holly True Garces. And I have plenty of more posts that will be encouraging and uplifting. So thank you guys so much for your support. And I hope you guys have a great week. Thanks.
This is Pastor Debbie Kasinger with Lifeline Church. And this is Kingdom News Now. And it's time for you to testify.
Welcome back to Kingdom News Now. We are so glad that you joined us tonight and so excited about this program. Amen. We got Pastor Greg Gilberto from North Point Nazarene from here in Poplar Bluff with us, and then also Pastor Ed Shirrell from Sabbath Rest Retreat Center in Zalma, Missouri. And we've been talking about what Sabbath Rest is and really the ministry that God has called Brother Ed and his wife into. And Brother Ed, I want you to share some things. You talked a little bit a while ago. You shared a few statistics about pastors and how they burn out and how many leave the ministry each month and such. And you said it was like 1,500
a month.
I like to ask him, because being a pastor, sure. what is a burnout pastor look like? What if you would give us an idea of what that looks like.
A burnout pastor, number one, is weary, which is normal, but the fact that he is overextended, you're having dinner with your family, the phone call comes, you are not just irritated, you reach the point that your family and you resent people. The very people you're wanting to love on, you are tired and weary, and now you are backing away from them. And that's a good one. Another's overextended. Your calendar's full.
Mm-hmm.
My wife tells us we have a date night on Friday night. So when people call and say, Pastor, can you do this and this and this? Often I can, but if I don't protect my family
right.
and my time, how can I win your family and lose my family?
Right.
Overextended, absolutely. Weary, just you resent people. When you resent the people you're trying to love on, it doesn't take a prophetic person to pick up on that.
Amen. Right. Amen. You know, talking just a while ago, you know, about our children, and you just mentioned again about your family sitting down to family dinner and eating dinner. You know, if you're not careful, let me talk to you, Pastor. If you're not careful, and I know if you've been pastoring very long at all, you know this, and that is that your children will grow up to resent the ministry.
Yes.
You know, if they feel like the ministry takes so much more of your time than what they can get. And the truth is, we've all been there. Every one of us have been there.
Yeah.
To where I know our children feel that way from time to time and resent the ministry and such. And then they don't want any part of it once they grow up. Yeah. And I'm not saying it's like that in every situation or every family, but I do believe we have to guard against that.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly what you're doing.
Yeah, you need to set boundaries, and your congregation may or may not understand it, but it's
right.
up to you.
Right.
But the spiritual warfare, we all know about it.
Amen.
But when you become a pastor, you're a target for the enemy.
Absolutely.
Right.
And there's a cliche that I don't like. It says, well, if you strike the shepherd, the sheep will scatter. It's true.
It is true.
And so I had a pastor come this summer, and I'm still working. I don't have the lodge open. And in the midst of our conversation, I asked him, I said, I'm a Vietnam vet. He said, I was in the military. I said, well, what did you do? He said, I was a sniper. Wonderful. You understand spiritual warfare. The enemy shoots at you or your family in different directions,
right.
and you don't know where it's coming from. So if you don't take time to pray and rest, the enemy's, the Bible says, he's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour.
Right.
And the average pastor, either you have people in your congregation who impose unrealistic expectations on you. They watch the guy on TV, big church. They expect you to be super pastor, super counselor, super buddy, super life group leader. It's impossible.
Right.
And then sometimes in ministry, we do what 1 Corinthians says is unwise. We compare ourselves with somebody else, and we self-impose unrealistic expectations.
On ourselves. Which is a burden in itself.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And to a pastor, if you're listening tonight, it takes faith to practice a sabbatical, to rest, reflection. Just like you teach your congregation to tithe, you believe that God can bless their 90% more than you can do with your 100%. It takes time to obey God, but God is going to grow your church. You're not going to grow
Amen.
Your church.
Boy.
And so if you're disobeying, and I don't mean legalistically here,
right.
but if you're doing it wrong, it takes faith. And I know it takes faith. You may have not someone to fill in your pulpit or to watch your congregation. But find a small group of pastors.
Amen.
Find somebody to talk with. Ask people to pray for you.
Right.
I was at a church a while back, and I asked a businessman who's a board member, and I said to him, I know how to approach a board from a pastoral mindset, why they should invest in their pastor. Tell me what a businessman thinks. And this guy is very blunt. He said, tell your pastors to be honest. I said, could you tell me what that means? I think I know.
Right.
He said, you asked the pastor, how are you doing? Fine. How's your family? Fine. How's your finances? Fine. The reality is, as pastors, as Sunday morning, it doesn't matter what your day's like or your week. You suck it up and you get up there and you
right.
ask God to use you. But you need some people you can be honest with
right.
and say,
yes.
I am hurting
yes.
yeah.
and not feel guilty about
Absolutely.
It because I'm not Superman.
Yeah. And you got that Monday morning, I'm done with this again.
Right.
Yeah. You got to fight through that on a regular basis.
Yeah.
This retreat center is going to probably infuse new life into the kingdom. I really
Amen.
Think it will. Once, especially when it starts going and you get some. I think what's also going to happen is you're going to see a brotherhood of pastors that, man, I've been there, done that. You know, man,
Right.
It's all of us. All of us feel that.
Brother Ed, you've got some things here. I know that you've got reasons for burnout.
Reasons for burnout. It's just these unrealistic expectations, spiritual warfare. It takes faith to do it. It takes a little self-discipline. You know, the word disciple implies some discipline.
Absolutely.
So I've got to discipline myself. And again, I'm not legalistic, but if I follow God's plan, my family's going to be healthier. The ministry he's called us to, it's not my ministry anyway, it's his ministry.
Right.
So
right.
if I'm doing that, I'm going to help produce health.
This is really good.
And I have a son, he's 38 today. He's a staff pastor. He's been in ministry for 12 or 13 years, worked with me for 12 years. He grew up and people would call our house at dinner time. He became the counselor on the phone. So as a pastor, we did our best to protect him from the dark side of ministry. And I'm saying, when you're healthy, we'd go on vacation and something would happen in the church and they'd want us to come back. And we, unless it was a dire emergency, we didn't come back.
Right.
And I, as a mercy person, I would feel guilty, but I'm glad I followed through because the fruit's in my son and my wife. And God wants us to do that.
Amen.
Amen. I want you to take just a few minutes tonight and kind of target the congregation.
Yes.
And I realize by what you're hearing and listening to tonight, it sounds like we're just simply strictly talking to pastors. And maybe that's where most of the focus is on this program tonight as a pastor. But there's a part that applies to you as part of the congregation as well, and not just the pastor. And Brother Ed is going to kind of give that to you tonight. If you're a part of the congregation tonight and you're trying to figure out, okay, what part do I play in this? What would you tell them?
Well, I would call you, you're a family. You're a church family. If you want your pastor to have a fresh word for you, he has to have time to have a fresh word.
Right.
If you want him to produce health in your children and your grandchildren and your college-age children and your marriage class, whatever, invest in him. Healthy pastors, God can use to produce a healthy church.
Amen.
If you burn out your pastor, if you constantly call him, there's nothing wrong with calling your pastor when you have a need. But there are times when you call him for a phone number. You may not realize it. If your congregation's 100 people, you got 100 people calling for a phone number.
Mm-hmm.
How much time does that take away? Write your pastor a note of encouragement. Encourage your church leadership to invest in a sabbatical for your pastor. There's something about the number 7 in the Bible. I'm encouraging churches to put in their staff manual every 7 years a 30-day sabbatical for their pastor. I'm also asking for them every year, give your pastor 2 or 3 days twice a year to time to reflect, and it will produce fruit in your congregation. It's for your good that you invest in your pastor. It's not just for his sake or her sake.
Amen. So tell us, now we've covered a lot of it from this side of it, but first of all, tell us where it's at.
The ministry today.
The ministry itself.
We're a few months from opening a lodge. We could use some help in various items. We'll come back to that later. But we're looking for people to pray for your pastor. So if I have a pastor to come, and I'll just say it's Pastor Greg, I might be able to share his initials, GG, I'm sorry, to pray for this pastor.
Right.
Because if it's spiritual warfare, you need people praying for him.
Yeah.
So I might send out on an email, I have GG coming from March the 1st through March the 7th. Would you pray for him, his wife, and his children?
Isn't that awesome?
And pray during that time.
While that's going on,
While that's going on. And so we're hoping to simply provide that place. I hope to have a buffet of resources there for burnout, for marriage, for small groups in your church, for parenting, a number of things that your pastor, he may or may not have time to go to conferences. But every pastor I know that has a shepherd's heart wants to feed his congregation.
Right.
People would say to me, Pastor Ed, what's your primary job description? I am to lead and feed my congregation.
Right.
And I'm not a natural leader, but I know how to feed them.
Yeah.
But living on a farm, if you don't put hay in the barn, you have nothing to feed them. You aren't always going to get, if you're a congregation, your pastor isn't always going to get a rhema special word on Saturday night for you.
Right.
He needs time to study.
Yeah.
And when pastors study, the congregation knows it. And when he didn't study,
they know it
too.
That's right. Amen.
So
you know, Ed, I could see knowing that, you know, we were there today, and how, like I said, how beautiful it was. I could see us, like, you know, popping in a DVD that I may not have access to, you know, in my congregation or in the area, and you'll have that available. We can sit there, watch that, Jackie and I, or whatever, and, you know, just with nothing else going on, and going, oh yeah, because when you're being ministered to, it's easier to minister when you come out.
Absolutely.
And I can see that that would be a big, and we're going to do our best to help you with your library and stuff. I think what the Lord has done for us, Jack will tell you that part of the Popular Bluff family is we find places to hook up and network, and we do really well with that. And we're going to do that with Sabbath Rest.
Yes,
we're ready
yes.
to pour in and as you pour out. I mean, mm-hmm. we got to find a way to make this thing work. Yeah, there's needs, and, you know, there's you need toasters and some microwaves. That's going to come.
Right.
Maybe
right.
put that on their website or something
right.
and find out there's some needs here. Right. But right now, you're really close to a target date. You say spring. Is that like March?
March, April.
And when that happens, we already talked about our men's prayer group going over there and
yes.
kind of doing a dedication. That sounds kind of cool, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Maybe we may spend a week.
I thought we'd already talked about that maybe Greg and Jackie and Jack and Lisa would be your first customers.
It's very possible.
That's what we were talking about. I know Lisa's right here.
Awesome. I come home today telling her all about the place, you know, and so she said, when can we go?
Yeah,
I said, I mentioned maybe we might be the first customers.
But believe it or not, I've had people, pastors asking me for a year if they could come. And I said, I'm sorry, it's not open. But there is a need there. I've had
absolutely,
other people say, do you think pastors will come? I said, absolutely. Then it's just a matter of communication, getting the word out. And they say, well, what are you going to have them do? Nothing.
Nothing. On purpose. Nothing's on purpose.
There's no cable TV. You know, there's like
no
we said
Wi-Fi.
Earlier, there's no Wi-Fi, no internet, very, very limited cell phone service you have any.
We may have to talk to each other again.
Yeah.
What a concept.
You wouldn't text across the room to each other.
No, we wouldn't.
I know it's beautiful, and we have showed some pictures throughout the program tonight, and I know it is a beautiful facility and very spacious, large rooms.
Serene.
Staircase, wow.
The staircase is spectacular.
Awesome.
Yeah. It is a focus. It's the prettiest staircase I've seen in a long time.
Can I say one more thing to the congregation? It isn't just about your pastor. It's about your pastor's wife.
Yes, that's why I wanted to go there a while ago.
She handles more stress, I think, than the pastor because
Amen.
She doesn't have an outlet.
Amen.
And there's a scripture somewhere. When you find it, tell me the bookmark. But it says, if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. But it means this.
It's the message, I'm sure.
If your pastor's spouse isn't happy, wife, so you're investing in, they're a team. Just imagine
that's
your
right.
marriage. Let's just say you're in business. We're in God's business.
Amen.
You're in business and your spouse isn't happy,
yeah.
isn't ministered to. Can I tell you, your business isn't going to succeed.
That's right.
And surely we can be smarter than the world. We're supposed to be
Amen.
As wise as a serpent, harmless
Amen.
As a dove.
That's right.
So invest
Amen.
In the. And again, people have said, can we bring our group? You cannot. It's for pastors and their wife,
right.
our missionaries. And it's not for retired pastors.
Right. Ministers.
Ministers.
Right.
It's for people who are active in ministry.
Right.
Yes.
Later, as we have more cabins, hopefully we can accommodate more people. But this is the target we're shooting
Give
for.
Us the physical location.
Physical location, I'm about 45 minutes northeast of Popper Bluff. I'm about 45 minutes west of Cape Girardeau. I'm an hour and a half from Farmington. I'm 2 hours from Festus. I'm 2 hours from Carbondale. On a map, if you find Puxico, Missouri, there's Mingo Wildlife Refuge mm-hmm. Center. I'm about 12 or 13 miles from there. It's in the middle of nowhere. My address is Zalma. I'm 10 miles from Zalma. So
right,
your GPS will get you close, but it will not get you to where I'm at.
When you get close, you call Ed. That's what we did.
Look for the white cross.
That's right. Look for the white cross.
We will send you directions.
Yes.
Yeah, beautiful
yes,
place.
Yes, it is a beautiful place. And give us a contact information, source phone numbers.
You can. My email is PastorEdShirrell@gmail.com. My phone number is 573-238-7769. Again, love to help you, Pastor, any way we can. I do not have an agenda here except to be a blessing to you. Because that'll bless the kingdom.
Amen.
I believe whatever God's going to do in the last day, is going to come through the local church, and the pastor is the key.
Yes.
I'm for big church organizations, Absolutely. Parachurch organizations, television ministries, but the boots on the ground are with the local church, Amen. And the pastor is the key. And Amen. That's why spiritual warfare Amen, is so great Preach against it. That pastor.
Yes, sir.
You know, I've said this for many, many years, and that is that, you know, I love the Christian television, obviously. I love Christian television, and I love what they're doing, the job they're doing for the kingdom of God. But everything that Jesus taught,
yes,
it come right back to the local church. That's what he taught about. Amen. Everything that he taught came back. All of his teachings came back to and through the local body, the local church. And so that's what it's about. We've been talking tonight with Pastor Ed Shirrell and Pastor Greg Gilberto and such, and we're so glad that you've joined us tonight. And I know you've enjoyed the program. And again, I know we've kind of targeted pastors tonight, but I believe it's necessary, as well as what Ed had shared just a few moments ago about the statistics and all of them that gets out of the ministry and no longer than they stay in the ministry and such. And we're not saying that we're looking at some of you in this local area tonight that have done that or are considering that, but I'm just telling you, I pastored myself long enough to know that if you've been pastoring very long, you need the help of this man.
Amen.
You need to find out some more information about Sabbath Rest in Zalma, Missouri. And so, Brother Ed, we're so glad that you've chosen to be with us tonight.
Thank you.
And Greg, it's always good to have you, amen, on the program. You have actually done very different, very well, but not that you did bad before.
See, Ed, I don't know. What do you? I need a retreat, brother. I need to go somewhere. No, it's good. I appreciate it. You know what? I met this man. We met 6 months ago or something. And you know somebody, when you meet him and your spirit goes, yes.
Yeah.
This is Ed Shirrell. He's got a heart, pastor's heart. He's our HB London in the area. He's a pastor to pastor. We're excited that he's part of what's happening. I'm excited for this thing.
Amen.
And Lisa, we'll go. If Jack won't take you, you know what? I'm telling you, I could see Jackie and you and myself. We could sure. really have a great retreat.
We'd have a great time. And not just about fun. That's not what we're talking about. But we would have a time of rest.
No, I want to have fun.
And we would have fun.
Yeah.
But that's just a given wherever we are. If
that's
we're
right.
in McDonald's.
The
or
joy of the Lord is our strength. Hallelujah.
Wherever we are, we'd have fun. But
that's right.
One other thing, Jack. You could follow us on Sabbath Rest Retreat on Facebook. You can see pictures. You can find us, how to contact us, information there, Sabbath Rest Retreat.
Amen. I'm glad you are here to bring this thing back around where we're supposed to be.
Yeah, we're just not having fun.
Amen. But we're so glad that you joined us tonight on this program. We trust you've been blessed. And be sure and check us out on Facebook.com/KingdomNewsNow. And you can view any of the programs and most all the programs. Let me say it like that. Most all the programs are up. And so we just appreciate that. If you have a prayer request, a need that you need prayer, call the number that's on the screen, 573-840-8888, and there'll be somebody there to pray. If you don't get an answer there, be sure and leave a number. If the phone's busy or voicemail or whatever, be sure and leave a request with your name and phone number, and I promise you 100% somebody will call you
there
back.
You go.
Amen. And we will pray for you. We will plug you in. If you need direction or help, we'll do our best to help you
That's
any way
good.
That we can.
Hey, Jack, can we do – I know we've got – looks like we've got 3 minutes left on the on the signal. Can we pray for this
Absolutely.
New ministry?
Absolutely.
I think that would be really cool just to have our people pray with him.
Absolutely.
Can we just do that right
just
now?
Just go right ahead.
Yeah, let's
Amen.
Do that.
Amen.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for Ed, Cheryl. We thank you, Lord, for his beautiful wife, Karen. And we're asking that you would just bless this ministry. Father, from this day forward, I know, Lord, the foundation's been built, the building's up, and now it's time for real ministry to happen. Lord, I just pray in Jesus' name that every need that's left, there's sheets and there's toasters and microwave, there's some things, you know how long the list is, but Father, even before that happens, we know that the scripture says, you know what we have in need of before we even ask.
Yes.
Now, Father, I thank you that Sabbath Rest Retreat is anointed of God. It's going to be awesome. I pray blessings on it. And Lord, help us to see this thing through.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
How's that? Will that
amen.
Work?
That's, right. that's awesome. Amen. Don't forget, when Satan has a plan to kick you out.
Come on.
You know what it is. God's got a plan to keep you in. Amen. God bless you.
Amen.
Hello, friends.
I'm Jack Dilday of Kingdom News Now, and I want to take just a couple moments to share something with you that's very dear to my heart tonight, and that is Midnight Cry Intercession. Back when Lisa and I were pastoring locally here in Poplar Bluff, we began Midnight Cry once a month on Friday nights. We would gather together to pray for the needs of others and intercede for those that was in need of anything from the Lord. And we would pray from 8 o'clock till midnight once a month on Friday night. And we would gather prayer requests from anywhere around the area, anywhere around the country, actually anywhere in the world that we knew people that needed prayer for any specific needs. And we would pray for those during those 4 hours from 8 till midnight once a month on Friday night. But when we transitioned from pastoring locally here in Poplar Bluff to the program here at Kingdom News Now, we set up our Facebook page called Midnight Cry, and we began to take prayer requests through that avenue. And so I want to talk to you for just a few moments tonight, really what Midnight Cry is and how important it is. I not only believe just to us, but I believe it's important for you and to God as well. So, you know, intercessory prayer is a type of prayer that you put yourself in between the enemy and someone else who has a need. You know, you begin to intercede for them. Jesus was the great intercessor. He put himself between death and us. So when we begin to intercede for someone, what we are doing in essence is putting ourselves in between that person and the enemy, which puts us closer to the enemy than what they are. And we stand in between them and the enemy, and we pray and we intercede. You know, we're not required to do what Jesus did. We're not required to give our life such as he gave for you and I. But we are required to do something, and that's pray one for another. God does use those who will place themselves between the enemy and someone else. He calls people to do that. And not only does he call people to do that, I know our first thought is, well, you know, I'm not called to be an intercessor. Well, I beg to differ with you, because I believe, number one, James chapter 5, I believe it's verse 8, James chapter 5, verse 16 says, pray ye one for another that you may be healed. So you are called to pray for others. You are called to intercede for others. If you are born again, child of God, if you know Jesus Christ is your Savior and you claim to be on your way to heaven, you are called to pray one for another. You are called to intercede. You are an intercessor. You know, we're to intercede not only for one another, but we're to intercede for our nation. No other day in history does our nation need any more prayer than what it does today. This nation's in a mess. This nation is divided right down the middle. And the answer is not going to be found in who's in the White House. The answer is going to be found in God's house. The answer is going to be found with God's children. The answer is going to be found on our knees, praying and seeking and interceding for our nation. That's where the answer is going to come from. That's the only thing that's going to turn this nation around and turn it back to God. And we are called to do that. You know, I mentioned James chapter 5, verse 16 says, pray ye one for another that you may be healed. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 8 teaches us that what we make happen for one, God will make happen for us. When we begin to pray and intercede for someone, God will lay it on someone else's heart to pray and intercede for us. That's just the way he works. I don't know how it happens. He just does that. Pray ye one for another that you may be healed. I'm called and anointed to pray for you so I can get what I need. You are called and anointed to pray for someone else so you can get what you need. We need to take the focus off of ourselves and place it on someone else. That's what intercession is when we begin to pray for someone else besides ourselves. And you are called to be an intercessor. And I want to invite you to take just a moment to go to our Midnight Cry Facebook page, and the address is on the screen, facebook.com/midnightcry, the number one, like the page, and post your most urgent need on that page. And know that people from around the world is praying for you. And not only are they praying for you, but you have an obligation and responsibility to be praying for them as well. Scroll through the page, find the prayer request that's on there, and begin to pray for those needs that's on there. I know God will bless you for it. I know it's not only close to my heart, I believe it's close to God's heart. You are called to be an intercessor. You are anointed to pray for people. You're anointed to pray one for another, and God will see to it that your needs are met. Amen. Thank you.
No place I would rather be. No place I would rather be.